We are little bit tweaking with the session plan, and we are taking the session which we are originally planning to have from 3:15. Actually, it is 3:15. So this is the panel discussions based on the enhancing capacity building in financial literacy and inclusive. And we are so lucky that we have a very distinguished panel today. I just introduce with our panelists. We have Mr. Mr. Chandan Sinha, Additional Director, CAFRO. Shri Sinha is Additional Director, responsible for learning activities of CAFRO. He has a career span of 35 years with Reserve Bank of India. As an Executive Director, his responsibilities cover the areas very diverse, such as supervision of banks, non-banking financial institution, internal debt management, foreign exchange department, financial market regulations, payment and settlement system, information technology, and management of forex reserves. There cannot be more distinguished person. I welcome you, sir, if you could come on the stage. We are also extremely lucky we have Dr. Jibendu Narayan Mishra, CEO, Indian Institute of Banking and Finance. Dr. Mishra is Chief Executive Officer of Indian Institute of Banking and Finance, and prior to joining IIBF, he was Deputy Managing Director and CEO of State Bank of India. Dr. Mishra had over 35 years of experience in State Bank of India and held various positions. His exposure is a typical blend of technology with banking, as well as in the areas of academic excellence. We invite you, sir, on the dais. We are also extremely lucky to have Dr. K. Hinda, Director, National Institute of Banking Management. He has over 35 years of rich and diverse experience in the banking and financial sector, overseeing credit, project appraisal, merchant banking, financial services, credit rating, industrial finance, resource mobilization. He has also been associated with the World Bank project like IBRDA, IDA funding, risk management, housing and infrastructure finance. He has also considerable expertise in the area of infrastructure development and revival of Sikh public sector enterprises. We welcome you, sir. And to moderate the session, may I invite Director Shri Sandeep Ghosh, who has actually worked with most of them at some point of time or other, Mr. Ghosh.
So, you've been hearing me since yesterday, so I'm not going to say much. The general desire to have this panel was principally that IIBF virtually takes care of the whole gamut of banking where certification is concerned. In fact, their certificate, which is used to be known as CAIIB and now has different connotations, was a sort of a compulsory qualification if you wanted to survive in the banking industry. If you also ask some of the erstwhile Reserve Bank people who could not do this qualification, would find it very difficult to survive in the bank. And many people actually left the bank because they could not pass this qualification. Chandan Sinha's CAFRO actually does the senior most executives in the banks. And Mr. Dhingra's NIBM virtually handles from induction to the topmost executives and has also been the place where the finance ministry had their Gyan Sangam and the prime minister was there to discuss the future of banking and things like that. So the one thing which has come out over the period of time that maybe we don't have shortage of content, we don't have shortage of resources. The problem which we have is only two. One is we do not have enough people who can work in this area. And as mentioned by Chetna, we do not have enough people who have that power to empower. You have to take a call that the other person is right and that I may need to change to bring about the change which he or she is looking at. So I was just wanting to get a brief. So what I'm going to do is to allow them some small time, 5-7 minutes, to basically give an idea what exactly, and to the larger public, all of you know these institutions, that what exactly is the major focus when they run these huge training and capacity building institutions. What exactly is their major focus? And after that, we'll ask some questions, and I'll also request you to ask some questions. We can start from Mr. Dhingra.
Dr. Ghosh, Dr. Lisha, and Ms. Chandrasena, and dear participants, it's indeed a pleasure to interact with you this afternoon. I owe a lot of gratitude to Dr. Sudeep Ghosh, who has provided me this opportunity to participate in this second forum. Well, as far as the financial inclusion is concerned, I think there the Government of India, various ministries and the commercial banks and the institutions promoted by our friend who was last speaker, they have to play their role, but we definitely owe a lot of responsibility to our countrymen, half of which are less than 25 years of age, and 23 crore of us are above 60 years of age, to impart them financial literacy. I think this initiative of the four regulators is highly laudable and supportworthy. And I have a feeling that it's not only that we owe responsibility to the persons who are school going or the boys or the persons who don't understand the financial language. We basically need to have the financial literacy for the persons like us also. I think all of us claim that we are financially literate persons. Half of us may not be knowing what is our CIBIL score. Half of us may not be knowing how we improve our CIBIL score. Half of us may not be knowing yet what is MCLR and how MCLR has made a difference of 1-2% on our borrowings. Half of us may not be knowing that we can prepay our housing loans also with no cost. Many of us may not be knowing as to what are the provisions of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016, which is every day in the news, where a small creditor or even an employee or a tea vendor who has supplied the milk and the tea bags to a corporate can also invoke the provisions of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. They are called operational creditors. This is a category which has been included for the first time. Many of us may not be knowing about the RERA. Many of us may not be knowing about the RERA's guidelines, and all the states have implemented the RERA Act and they put the RERA authorities in place. So there are a lot of things which are happening. Even at the age of 60 also, I feel surprised that even a wrong decision on my part to make my investment in a wrong instrument can do me. So it's very important for all of us to understand the financial literacy, and in case we are financially literate, to help our countrymen to understand this concept. And they should take the decisions as per their risk appetite. It's not that they have to buy the mutual fund products. It's not necessary that they have to buy the insurance products. They have to buy the product which is as per their risk appetite. Even the cost of his investment may be better as compared to a mutual fund or an insurance product in case the risk appetite of a person doesn't permit that type of investment in the insurance or in a mutual fund. Well, I represent the National Institute of Bank Management, the oldest institution for the training and capacity building of the senior officers of the banks and financial institutions. We were set up in 1969 by Reserve Bank of India. That was the time that the Government of India nationalized the first 14 banks. And we have been now in existence for the last about 48 years. And we have been doing the training and capacity building for the senior officers of the banks, financial institutions. And senior officers means chief manager and above. And we have a track record of training most of the present CMDs or the MDs and CEOs of the public sector banks. There are about 21 public sector banks, and I have interacted with all of them after my taking over this position. Most of them, they have confessed with me that they have been to Manavian not only once, more than once, at times as a guest faculty, at times as a participant also. And all of them, they cherish very fond memories of their coming to Manavian. We have got a campus in Pune, the most beautiful campus which I have seen. I don't want to undermine the campus of NISM, but once you come to NIBM, you can see that NIBM, probably we don't have any campus which is comparable to NIBM campus. It's wonderful. It looks like a resort, and it has got many birds, and the chirping of the birds is something which you cannot find anywhere in the country. And we take credit that we are participants have been increasing year after year. 2015, we had close to about 6,000 participants. In 2017, we had close to about 6,000 participants. The participants have gone up by 50%, 100%. And our overseas participants have gone up by more than 100%. About 2 years back, we had about 450, and last year, we had about 870 overseas participants. And number of training programs which we conducted last year was 222, which has gone up by 50%. In addition to conducting the training program for the banks and financial institutions, we also have got a PGDM in the field of banking and financial services. And this is AICTE approved. It's like MBA in the field of banking and financial services. And it's highly respected in the field of banking or finance. There is a Supreme Court embargo for the public sector banks to come and recruit the boys and girls from our campus. Because as per the Government of India rules, every public sector has to give same opportunity to the public at large. So they cannot come to our campus and pick up, but we have a track record of placing all of them. And every package last year which our student got was about 11 lakhs rupees, and yesterday I got the information that every package may go to 13 lakhs rupees. And we also do a lot of consultancy, we do a lot of competency mapping and succession planning for the public sector banks and the private sector banks also, and we are conducting a lot of training programs which are absolutely required, keeping in view the present day requirement of the banking industry. Yesterday I was inaugurating a program on IBC 2016, which basically speaks of IBBI, which is again under the Ministry of Finance, regulated under the Ministry of Finance, Ministry of Corporate Affairs, and NCLT and NSCLT also. And we are also now starting a program on 20th, which is for the offices of the banks which are under PCA. PCA is Prompt Corrective Action, which is a step taken by Reserve Bank of India for the so-called weak banks, so that they can improve their financial position and start lending again. So we are very active in the field of banking and financial services. And we have done a lot of consultancy assignments. I think we are likely to do some consultancy assignment for the Commonwealth of Learning also, this madam. I think for your bank, I think the Commonwealth of Learning has been talking to us for doing an impact assessment of the funding which they have done for your projects. And I take credit that we have been doing a little bit of for the financial literacy also, but we want to increase our role, and we want to be an integral part of the drives of the four regulators, and we will be very interested to accept any role which can be assigned to us for being actively involved in this initiative. And 1 minute. This initiative has to be a little more visible, it has to be vibrant, it has to involve many more actors. I think I have interacted with the madam, I have interacted with Seva also. We have to be more aggressive also. And in case we want to make this drive a really successful drive of the four regulators or the Government of India also, maybe that we have involved some more ministries also, so that it becomes a compact drive for all the ministries which are basically talking of the financial inclusion, or they are talking of financial literacy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dinda sir. Dinda sir, since you talked about the campus, those who have not seen an IBM, an IBM is a beautiful campus. I used to be on the board of an IBM for one decade. So I'm very familiar to an IBM. But they have a rich campus. It is of approximately 60 acres, of which 40 acres is forest land. So they have that advantage. We inherited 70 acres of barren land. 70 acres of barren land which we have grown it into this campus. And given the heritage of 40 years, we will have the same amount of trees here also. That's on the lighter side. But an IBM has the trees over there, the chandan trees and the teak trees, unbelievable. That's a huge, but today we have a limitation that you can't cut and reforest. Otherwise, it is a gold mine which they have there, and they are constantly challenged by the land mafias who are eyeing that forest land to cut and make some buildings there. So let me now request Mishraji to share what IIPF is doing and does it contribute to financial literacy and inclusion in any way.
Dr. Ghosh, thank you very much for inviting me in beautiful campus of NISM. Dr. Tinga, and Dr. Chandan Sinha, and all distinguished dignitaries who are attending this seminar. When we talk about learning, I am always reminded of a saying of our father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhi, who said, "Live as if you are to die tomorrow. Live as if you are to die tomorrow. Learn as if you are to live forever." And that is the essence of lifelong learning. And lifelong learning is not important only for the people who are so-called learned or so-called educated, but the lifelong learning, the spirit of lifelong learning is ingrained in every human being. And when I was hearing the mesmerizing presentation of Chetnaji, I was thinking that how little I know, because she knows much more what is happening in the grassroots level. And when we are talking about financial literacy, she also emphasized that financial common sense is more important in this area. When we talk about financial literacy and financial inclusion, an AND word is very important. Because when you talk about financial inclusion, what comes first? Obviously, financial literacy comes first. Because unless you have financial literacy, you will not be successful in your financial inclusion program. And this was shown by no other than our regulator, Reserve Bank of India. Way back, about two decades back, they have introduced some literature in this area in the form of comics, in the form of games, and tried to spread this financial literacy program to the masses. When we talk about financial literacy and financial inclusion, I think there are two aspects of it. Target group is two. One is bankers or the people, service providers, who are providing the service in order to include people in the financial system. And the other part is the people who are receiving that service. And financial literacy is important for both of them. In IIPF, Dr. Ghosh asked us to introduce about the institute. So I'll talk a little bit about the institute. In IIPF, we also realize the importance of financial literacy in the financial inclusion place in our country. And way back in 2006, we published a book on financial literacy, Readings on Financial Inclusion. And that book became very popular in this field. And since our focus is to develop professional bankers, I talked about two target groups. Our focus is on the first target group, bankers and the service providers who are providing service in order to achieve financial inclusion. Now, to that end, we have introduced many programs, and as Mr. Dr. Ghosh was introducing, our institute, although named as Indian Institute of Banking and Finance, but commonly known as CIA Institute, because right from we are 90 years young, we were established in 1928, much before Reserve Bank of India came into existence. And since then, from 1928 onwards, the CIAB exam is being conducted by the institute. But the institute has gone much ahead of CIAB and GIAB. Although CIAB continues to be our flagship programs, right now we are offering 9 diploma courses, 18 certificate courses. We have blended programs, 7 blended programs, and then we have advanced management program, which is a key to executive MBA. And about 300,000 people take our exams every year. So, as Dr. Ghosh was rightly mentioning, certification is our core area. Other than certification, we are also in other space, like publication is a major activity. We have 60 books. We have 2 publishers, Macmillan and Taxman. We also provide training. Training is vertical was introduced from 2012. And then we also provide consultancy for setting up similar kind of institutes in other countries, especially in Southeast. Right now, consultancy program is going on with Nepal and Bhutan. So in nutshell, these are the different activities of the institute. Coming back to the financial inclusion and financial literacy space, we felt that business correspondent and business facilitators, they are very important component in the whole equation. And that is why we have introduced a certification program for BC and BF. And we also understood that this particular program will have to be offered in different vernacular languages. So we are offering this program in 11 languages. Our courseware has also been developed in all the languages, and exam is also conducted in 11 different languages in 250 centers all over the country. We have also done in our own humble way in achieving financial inclusion. We realized that IIBF alone cannot take care of the entire need of the country. So we have conducted Train the Trainers program. In association with the SFPCs of different states, we conducted this Train the Trainers programs in 20 centers across the country, and we have trained 970 trainers across the country. Now the model is, this BCBF who are actually working in the field, or those who aspire to become BCBF, they are called to RCTs. RCTs or FLCCs or banks training institutes, they are provided 3-day program, and at the end of the program, we conduct this online exam. So far, from 2015 to 2017, around 95,000 people have enrolled for our exam, and you will be happy to know that around 65,000 people have already got certified by us. So percentage-wise also it is quite good. So this is one humble way IIBF is contributing in developing proper financial literacy amongst the people who are providing service. Another important development has happened recently. Again, direction came from RBI to IBA to set up a expert committee to review the entire curriculum of this BCBF certification. So IIBF was also associated with it. We have reviewed the entire syllabus, and we have, that committee has developed a new syllabus, some inclusion has been made, some exclusion also have been made, so that it becomes more relevant for the people, because RBI also expects that the role of BCBF will be enlarged in days to come. So that modification is in process, and maybe another 2-3 months time the new program will be put in place. So this is one way institute is trying to work for the cause of financial inclusion in the country. I will stop here, and I will be more happy to take your questions at a later point in time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ali. BCBF is a major way forward for the banking sector, and it is just that if BCBF also become along with the certification become somewhat trained under Jethmaji's rural banking, I think the access will become tremendous. It is these type of forums which are very important to create interventions. I go back to a conference which CAB Pune held while I was the principal there. It was 2007-8. We did a conference, international conference on microfinance. And the recommendation for setting up BCBF was through that conference to RBI. RBI agreed that it is a good suggestion and we can take this forward. And a lot of good people came for that conference, especially Abhijit Banerjee and Esther Duflo, who used to do a lot of work and continue to do a lot of work in the space of microfinance. So these conferences become very important if you are able to do policy intervention, which is the desire of the Financial Literacy and Inclusion Conference, that if there are certain areas which we can recommend to the financial sector regulators, we would like to do that from the ground level experience which we will share in these conferences. And I now request Mr. Sinha to take us through some aspects of CAFRL, because Sinha Saab's CAFRL actually deals with the top management of bank on an ongoing basis. And since in India many things happen top down, maybe whatever they do will have an impact on the general financial space. Sinha Saab.
At the outset, of course, thanks to Sandeep and NISM for this wonderful opportunity. Initially, you think at this age, you know, why should you come and, you know, ab gyan leke kya karoge, you know. But I was quite humbled by the experience and whatever Chetna ji and whatever other presentations. So it's, you know, always useful. You still learn so much. And then, of course, you are under pressure to, you know, then make use of the learnings which you have done, which is not easy, actually. But let me get back to CAFRL. CAFRL is relatively new. We started in 2011. But of course, those of you who are seasoned bankers will know that there was the Bankers Training College, and then we are successors to the Bankers Training College. The reason, you know, we are not so much in focus is because we don't have our building as of now. You know, there's a government red tape, you know, we didn't get permission to rebuild BTC because it was close to the next to the sea. So we didn't get that permission. Finally, we got it last year, it started now. And as in India, it will take about 3 years before you see something like this. So I don't know whether Sandeep can be a kind of a consultant who can hurry things up. We have a campus soon. That said, of course, I have a little different take on training institutions, or per se training institutions. I take from what Sanjay mentioned during the day. See, everything is getting, we are like an intermediary, and you find most of the intermediaries are being kind of being disrupted and being, you know, short-circuited, so to speak. So what, you know, the kind of training we provide, like an educational institution, which I would say NISM is that, you know, on one side we are participants, on one side, other side we have a set of speakers or experts, and we kind of intermediate, and the cost of intermediation, I would say, is pretty high, because we have to recover our own costs, and you know, the more the buildings you have, then you have a more fixed cost to do that. But with the way things are evolving, and of course you have said that there should be, you know, you have to rethink, there should be a new way of doing it. Like for example, you know, the presentation or whatever that Sanjay made, it could have been done his video, wherever he's given it or what he's done today, can actually be piped directly to all the participants, you know, and probably you will get as much the same value. So in a sense, just like banking, you know, there's a threat to banking from the fintech, there's threat to, you know, a central counterparty or a central bank in the settlement process, which is coming through the blockchain technology. So also I think perhaps going ahead, and there's so much of e-learning which is now, you know, modules which are there and you're expected to self-learn, perhaps, you know, our role would, you know, actually get more minimized. But of course, I don't have to look that beyond. I'm worried about the next maybe 2-3 years. But, you know, just to be aware of how things could be. So CAFRAIL, getting back to CAFRAIL, we started in 2011. We have two verticals. One is research, one is learning, and I represent the learning or the training part. So far with a very small set of, you know, kind of faculty which we have. And on, of course, on the research side, we have now more more focus on the research side. Till this building comes up, perhaps the training would be a little bit subdued because you don't really have the space to do things alone. As Sandeep rightly mentioned, we concentrate on the senior top level to the senior management level. And our whole focus was to actually also provide a platform where the policy makers, regulators, and of course the market participants sit around, debate on a issue or a policy issue, and provide a key feedback, and then of course, enable better regulation making. But these are again, it keeps changing, you know, in the sense that, you know, it depends a lot on the regulator themselves, you know, there's a change there, there could be some kind of impact there. One impact, you know, for example, I don't know whether it's how it is NIBMU faring, you know, with both banks, as you mentioned, going under the PCA, there is no reluctance to send training people because the first thing when you control expenditure is by reducing training. Actually, you need more because you are not really up to it. You should be sending more, but the response is just the opposite, you know. So they cut down on the training, which actually becomes, you know, far more challenging to us. Compared to, you know, financial literacy, I would say our job is, you know, much, much easier because we deal with a very small select of educated professionals and who are all resource rich, you know. So they come from institutions who kind of, you know, pay for them. And our job is to augment the skills. So we're not really, you know, building in stuff, you know, which is actually a part of financial literacy. So to that extent, and the numbers being relatively small, the resources being, you know, much higher, both in terms of money, in terms of people who can do that, I would say it's a much easier task. When I look at the financial literacy space, I think Sandeep, somebody said yesterday, 80% is, you know, people are financially illiterate. So you are looking at such a large number of people, and you compound that problem with a stock and a flow problem. So you already have a stock which is 80%, you know, illiterate, and there's a flow, so the population keeps growing. Now you have to, you know, there are two ways of how do you tackle them. So you have to keep, the stock has to keep decreasing and the flow has to take care of itself. And there I would say that, you know, the only solution for the flow is that school literacy included in the school curriculum, both at the state level, at the central, you know, CBSE, ICSE level, so that automatically, you know, from now onwards at least, anybody who's going through a school is actually exposed to this financial literacy and it is automatically taken care of. The other interventions which, you know, the regulator is doing, NISM is doing, and many others is doing, can take care of the stock problem. And again, as Chetna ji has said, it actually needs a very segmented approach, and I think RBI also had a segmented approach. Farmers have a different needs, SMEs have a different needs, old generation has a separate need, so everybody has a separate need. And in this country, even before, you know, you had literacy, we are moving into financial literacy, and even before we have completed financial literacy, now we are talking about digital literacy, because, you know, there's so much trust there, and you find that people are unable to use, you know, so many apps, so many things which are actually probably may make life easy. So it's a huge, I would say, huge momentous problem, and ultimately I think the community has to be involved. It can't just be done by, you know, one regulator, one institution or few institutions. And of course, like the BC model which is there, the FLCC model of the RBI is there, there's several other interventions. So all have to work together, and ultimately you have to reduce We have to look at outcomes, look in their rating. I believe a survey will take place maybe in a couple of years' time or next year. Then probably you know whether you are still at 80, or you are in treadmill when you are running so much just to keep it at that level, or you have actually, you know, brought it 80 to 78 or 75. And there is a second order thing, whether you know in terms of outcome, how was the impact. But I think for India that problem is still far away. Let us actually work with the numbers first, and let us first work with the flow. The flow should take care. And I can't see why these, you know, CBSEs and all are so reluctant to put a few hours of financial literacy course in their curriculum. I just don't understand, and this is, I've been hearing for almost maybe 10 years now. This, you know, here at Karnataka government, I think way back in 2011, when the first I heard yesterday, people talked about Meghalaya. I just can't understand why this is taking so long. So I'll stop here.
Thank you, Chandan. Actually, it's taking long because of one single sentence. Whenever you approach them, they say, we don't tell you how to do banking. Why are you telling us how to do teaching? So, then it becomes very... You can't say anything beyond that. I have been met, I think, in my last 5 years, I have met the principal secretary, school education of each and every state. I would have met all sort of chief secretaries. Everybody says it has to be done, but when you get to the exact last mile, they say, "Ki sahab, hum to aapko kabhi bolte nahi hai kaise banking karna hai." And it is quite surprising. Hamare paas itne panel of teachers hain, unhone kabhi nahi bola, aap bol rahe hain. So, it gives me an impression. They say, "Ki where have you come from?" And having said that. So we started it in a different way. We created content, we trained the teachers, we did their personal finance plan to tell them how they are totally not aligned to their own livelihood. And many of the states have now started looking. What Chandan was saying about Karnataka, we used to have a very close friend who was chief secretary there. So we told him, "Yaar, tum ho, kuch kar do." तो उसने कहा कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है जो दोगे हम करवा देंगे तो वी गेव हिम अ फुल कंटेंट एंड फाइनली व्हाट केम वाज वन लाइन इन दैट सिलेबस आउट ऑफ वन बुक वन लाइन केम कि फाइनेंशियल लिटरेसी इज इंपॉर्टेंट नाउ दैट वाज द सिलेबस व्हिच द चीफ सेक्रेटरी कुड नॉट इंप्लीमेंट ही वाज नोबडी एल्स बट मिस्टर सुधाकर राव हुज बेटर हाफ यूज्ड टू बी द एंबेसडर for US and China for a very long time. But that's the situation on the ground level. Everybody in India, they're very careful about our boundaries. And everybody says, ki bhai, jo bhi karo, hamare boundary mein nahi ghuso. Baaki jo tumko karna hai, karte raho. So it is better that we constantly keep on moving, keep on talking about these small issues like wants and needs, small issues like compounding, small issues like starting early in life, and if some of these, which we call in the language of Reserve Bank, FAME, financial awareness messages, if some of these financial awareness messages get stuck in the minds of people, maybe they would start looking at it in a different way. But we are addressing comprehensively different groups of people, as Chandan was saying. And when you heard or you saw that small video, which that's only one of them, actually there are multiple. In fact, what Sanjay also showed you, they are all on YouTube. Because he speaks virtually every second, third day on some subject or the other. Similarly, Chetraji speaks on these subjects every second. So if you want to look at the videos of Mahadeshi Banks or whatever they are doing, they are available. And they give you a lot of inspiration to do things and go ahead and do them. So these things are there in the space. The challenge is to get out of your comfort zone, because every time you want to do anything, you have to get out of your comfort zone. Otherwise, it cannot happen. Alternately, they say that if you cannot do, you teach. So many of us do that. They normally say, if you cannot do it, you teach. So if we can blend both teaching and doing, nothing like it. I will open it now to the house. And before that, I must tell you that there is a running tea coffee thing on the outside veranda. We are not breaking for tea anymore. We'll break now for the high tea. And that will be the close of the conference. But there is tea coffee, just if you step out. Anybody feeling slightly drowsy or whatever it is, please have tea coffee and come back. And I open it out to the audience in large. If you want to ask, or if you have some desire or wish list which these institutions should do, please do it now.
I want to say something which she highlighted, in which, you know, the regulators and all.
What I was saying, when we talk of, you know, things not being successful, like she said, I think that soul searching is not there. You know, no institution I know of does soul searching. Is there something wrong with my product, or is there something wrong with, you know? So perhaps when, you know, schools are not accepting a particular thing, you know, you have to involve them in the process of, you know, designing something which.
No, I get your point.
Perhaps that has not been done. You've designed something and you want to tell the school, now look, this, I've designed this book and I've designed this curriculum, do it. She pointed out, you know, you have to involve the, then they won't feel that it's the bankers getting into my territory.
No, let me just give you the, fill up the information gap. So when this happened and they would not want it, government didn't want it, school boards didn't want it. So we went the other way around. We directly approached the children. That, do you want to take a national financial literacy test? And I think everybody jumped into it. Not because they liked this, but because there were two things in it. The certificate was having the seal of all the five regulators. And they had my signature and a deputy governor's signature there. So, and India suffers from academic inflation. Everybody wants some certificate or the other. So children said, ki humko to ye certificate karna hai. Yep. Children said, then the school got into trouble. Ki kya kare, mane, these people are wanting to do the certificate. So they said, theek hai, ab aap bol rahe hain, to hum apne school mein certificate lagu kar denge. Then the second challenge was, we don't have content to teach, so we wrote the content. Class 6 to class 12 content was written and given to them. Then they said, we don't have teachers to train. Then we trained 5,000 teachers, and we are training every year 2,000 teachers. So you are very right. We are also not letting go. And people who know me, I normally don't let things go. 1984, we were talking about 5-day week. But we got it in 2004. Only because we were not ready to let go. So I can assure you, NISM doesn't let go. Just filling the information gap, that, and I've worked with Chetna for a long time to know that you can find the solution, nobody can tell you the solution, provided you want to find it. And each of the team who works, that is the small team who works actually, except for me and Mr. Garg, who spoiled the average age, the age of NISM is between 25 and 28. And they produce all the change which we are doing, and they do it, everything is in-house, whether it is our website, including NCFE, each and every model is also either a student or a somebody's child there. It is all in-house and a lot of effort is being done. So we are there, but I'm telling you, that was the normal reaction which we kept on working and found a solution which we are now feeling may happen over a period of time. Many states have started saying we don't bother. And to the extent now many states are saying we don't bother about CBSE or NCERT. Hum apne aap implement karenge. That is how the concept of Money Smart School came. That these schools register and say, humko board se koi matlab nahi hai, hum apne yahan karayenge. So that is happening. But I am saying, it is a, if we were ready to introduce GST and yoga by the nod of Prime Minister, then where is the problem of not being able to introduce a basic life skill for people in a country where the population is large and longevity is growing? We talked about Kali Pili taxi. Believe me, the average age of the driver of Kali Pili taxi is close to 68 years. There was a research. And many, when I say average age, there are people who are driving at the age of 85. Kabhi kabhar ghar galti se baith jata hai, I feel that fellow is not even wearing glasses. Can he see? But they have eaten food of pre-independence, which was good. So they are still driving Kali Pili without glasses. And believe me, there is no passion for them to drive. If they don't drive, they cannot take money home for food that evening. So it is, there is a movie which I would request all of you to see, The Return of One Idiot. Both the movies are good, One Idiot and the other is Return of One Idiot. The One Idiot talks about the current generation who feels that we are fools and we don't have way to think or way to move around, and then they see the right side of it. And The Return of One Idiot is somebody comes back to take care of the old person. Because India has 230 million people above the age of 60, and they require equal care. We say we are a young country, but today we are carrying them on our shoulder. Maybe tomorrow they will bring the future of India, but today we are carrying them on our shoulder because 50% of the population does not earn a single paisa. So it is a tough situation where we are involved. So questions, please. Questions, any suggestions which you want to give?
Thank you, sir. Today morning we saw the data, survey data. India is having more than 80% illiteracy, financial literacy is the problem we saw, and it was very specifically shown in the state wise. When we called Mumbai as a financial capital of the India, we saw, and I was very shocked that Maharashtra was falling into danger zone. Okay, well, Goa and Kerala and all other states are 1, 2, 3 numbers. I wanted to ask you that can we not all bankers, nationalized bank or private banks or commercial banks, this is not a corporate social responsibility, but this is opportunity. Can we make the ideal model of Kerala Grameen Bank, where they have done the miracles, so in Maharashtra also, like other states also, the bankers have this opportunity to go into financial literacy and financial inclusion.
You want to ask this question to anybody specific?
Yeah, because all our policy, you know, and turning to the CMDs of nationalized banks and all that things, so why we are lack of, you know, in Maharashtra, we are into danger zone, I saw the survey, Mani.
So actually survey are just indicators. I am giving you another survey result. Unfortunately, the CEO, the country head of CFA and the country head of Hong Kong CFA have just left. CFA along with us did a survey of 9 metros in October of 2016. And this was the survey was basically how much do these 9 metros do business in cash. Gujarat was 98%, and they were the people who got first hit when monetization came just after 10 days. We were doing this conference on 31st October and saying cash is the king in most of the metros. In fact, Mumbai, it was 68%. Business is done only in cash. Gujarat, it was 98%. So sometimes you feel that we are not, I'm sure Mr. Modi was not aware that Gujarat 98% cash is handled. And that was his state. and otherwise he would not have done demonetization. He felt it is Uttar Pradesh where more cash is handled. But it was actually Gujarat where the survey clearly says that. But all the metros showed more than 65%, because small businesses are handled only through cash. Not because they love it, but because they have to take money home for that evening meal. All the training establishments that they may want to have sessions with people who are doing work on the ground. At least the induction training, which is normally a longish type of training for people to come into an organization, if they are exposed that you will need to get out of the comfort zone of a table chair to be able to do sound banking, it may make a difference.
Hello sir, good evening. Sir, I wish to ask a question to Linda sir and Sina sir. This question is related to basic finance. Currently, government institution the one bill. I would like to ask, what is the present status of bail-in and bail-out activity in financial resolution and deposit insurance bill 2017? Because as a depositor, we too much concerned about that, whether our hard-earned money kept it with the bank or any other institution or any other sources or any other alternatives.
I'll give it an option for the people to answer, otherwise we can discuss it on tea. because maybe it may not be a very relevant question for this forum. Yes. But I do leave it to you if you all want to answer.
Broadly, bail-in is a new tool. Now you have to accept that. It is generally now a tool which has come post-crisis. In the context of lot of, you know, taxpayers' money, we needed to bail out private sector banks. So there, abroad everything is private, and then you found that, you know, there was a problem, the taxpayer bailed out. So conceptually, it is a good thing, the taxpayer money should not go in. Now, in the Indian context, it becomes a little fuzzy because the banking sector, 70% is owned by the government. Now, in a situation where the government owes 70%, will the bail-in tool will finally be used? That is a little bit questionable. So that's what people say, that don't worry. But once the act is there, it will be a new reality. And bail-in tool will be used as a last resort. So, for example, some banks are going through this process of prompt corrective action. I think the paper which was earlier, you know, the RBI committee which was there was that, you know, when a bank is in a problem, it goes through several stages, maybe five stages. In the last stage, it will move from the regulator to the resolution authority, because then it needs to be fixed. One way of fixing it is a bail-in. Bail-in, what happens is you lose, the depositor can also lose, so the equity goes, part of the bonds which are, you know, 81 whatever bonds which can be written down, they go. Then you come to a hierarchy where, you know, deposits beyond a certain deposit insurance whichever is covered goes down. So what should also happen, see, in the Indian context, what they should also do is, if you compare to the extent of insurance which is there in the, you know, European countries or the US is very high, $100,000, €250, something like that. Even in the UK it is very high. So ours is very low. That needs to go up substantially. The second thing is, lot of information about the banks should be there in the public domain. Like they do now in the US and Europe, they do the stress testing of banks, and you know that, you know where they stand. There are ratings of banks and things like that. So if you have a very enlightened population in India, and there is enough information is there, so you can also act in anticipation. So there is nothing to worry as of now at all. But, you know, maybe 10 years, 15 years, 20, we don't know. There will be additional tool which will be used, where you also as a stakeholder will lose, so that the rest of us do not lose. You were a depositor, you were there, you had all the information, and you were beyond the deposit insurance, so you will lose. Not the rest of us sitting around who are the taxpayers, just because your bank in which you had a deposit into a problem. So think in a very macro perspective. There is nothing which is there as of now. There is nothing which may arise also in a foreseeable future as far as the public sector banks. But ultimately, this is something which you should be aware of. It can be used.
Thank you, sir.
once it is part of the law.
Yeah. See, some of the cooperative banks are in trouble. So there's one particular bank called Rupee Bank, which is under moratorium for the last 1.5 years. And people are not able to lay their hands on their hard-earned money. My question is, can some of the, PSB, public bank, PSB, can they not take the lead and help those people and make sure that the public deposits are not, in trouble? For the last almost 1.5 years, people have been,
No, I think this is a big, and I know that there is this big anxiety to, since you have so many senior people from the capacity building institution, to start asking problems of banking rather than the problems of inclusion and financial literacy. I fully appreciate that. You have a DMD of State Bank, you have an ED of RBI, you have a very senior person heading an IBM. But let's keep this for high tea discussion. Okay?
Yes.
Can I?
Yes.
Yeah. Good evening, sirs. I run an independent learning center where I work with school children, and one of the subjects we work on is financial wellness. So I'm doing execution on the field. One of the reasons I'm running an independent learning center is it's very difficult to go to schools and conduct a class there. You know, same problem we encountered. My question, which is to maybe all of you, is other than providing this content which is on the website, are there any other avenues or ways to support people like me? So it can be other resources, it could be outcome linked funding, so what are the other ways that we can take help from you, we the people who are executing financial wellness in our independent capacity on the field?
So when you say we the people, what is your status?
So I'm an independent operator.
Independent means are you a trust, are you a society, are you an NGO?
No, I am a proprietor.
So you have to get converted into a larger body so that people have trust in you. Proprietary has not exuded too much trust in the system. So if you become a trust or a society and you are outcome-based organization, you can, today, as I am constantly mentioning since yesterday evening, there is no dearth of funding and support in the space of financial literacy and inclusion. And there are recognized bodies who are ready to help. But if you are a pure proprietor, then I think the scrutiny level becomes much more.
So effectively, and I think this is expected from me also, the filter is for profit versus not for profit. Loosely, yes. That's the filter.
Yes, that is the filter. Once it is not for profit, it is easier to attract funding. Even if it is, because I don't say you're doing for profit, it may be just not for profit, but your current status doesn't specify that. So once it specifies that, there are a lot of bodies who can facilitate it. In fact, you have the bigger body sitting on the last row who can tell you 14,000 crores in DEF account actually being used only for this purpose. And let me also tell you the other side of school. In fact, we have a resource persons program run with SEBI. We train resource persons and they do financial literacy inclusion in different spaces. Schools, college, mid-career, housewives, SSGs and retirement planning. Everybody goes to schools and we have now stopped it or we have told them jada school mein mat jaiye. Because schools mein kyun jaate hain? There is a classroom. The children cannot run away because the teacher is sitting. Aur jo aap bolenge bicharon ko sunna padta hai unko aur pasand aaye chana hai. So we made it tough for them ki bhai kuch school karo, but otherwise organize a place, get people and find out your level. Are you able to communicate the right things so that people can come back to listen to you on an ongoing basis? So you are doing good work. Keep in touch with us. We can always support. But if you want larger support, you have to look for not-for-profit.
Thank you.
Yeah. Can I?
Yes, please.
This is about school children getting trained in financial literacy. Just a thought came to me. These schools take the children for picnics and so many places and all that. But I find rarely many schools don't take them to banks and where they can get real financial literacy by first-hand experience. So why can't banks actually tie up the branches, tie up local schools and take them once in a while for this kind of education? Because when they go to the bank, then they get to learn a lot of things about how a bank works. Something like that can be taught off. One thing. Second is about, I have heard that banks give increments when new officers join. 3 increments, something, graduate increments or something. So I think graduate, it was something which was not there earlier. I think that concept is still going on. Today you don't find anyone joining a bank without even a graduation degree. So one of that increment can be converted into a term policy product where banks also distribute products, policy, insurance products. So it can be a sort of income for the bank as well as a good thing for the new guy who is joining the bank with a term insurance policy of 1 crore or whatever. So it works, it's good for both the candidate as well for the bank.
It's a good suggestion. I think most of the questions you are asking the moderator, not the panelists. No, I am telling you that you may not be aware. All financial sector regulators and head offices of banks have a structured visit of school children. In fact, if you go to BKC, half the financial institution has a separate cell managing the visit of school children. SEBI, NISM, RBI, each 30 centers of RBI, each has a financial literacy cell, and the financial literacy cell is only meant for school and college students. It not only does that, it runs a young scholarship scheme where school children come and learn about financial literacy. NISM does a summer program in financial literacy where global interns also come for 6 to 8 weeks just to be familiar to financial inclusion and financial literacy. So I think a lot of work happens in this area. And just let me put the things in right perspective. There is no graduate increment now available in the bank. Because if you throw a stone in Bombay, you will hit an MBA or an engineer. So graduates are no more in that much demand. So that is no more there. But you are very right, if at the part of first paycheck they were looking for a term insurance, it is the right time to take a term insurance. I must tell you, the younger generation is reasonably difficult. RBI wanted to introduce a term insurance of 1 crore for their staff, looking at the younger generation of people. Premium 40% to be paid by banks, 60% to be paid by staff, no takers. It is only in the last 5 years that finally a policy has come, which is a term insurance, where again bank contributes the larger amount of money and people take it. And what bank also has said, that part of this money we will keep in deposit and give it to you. So it has now come for the younger generation. It's not very easy because the mindset of insurance is, if I'm paying a premium, what are you giving to me? It's not transfer of third party risk.
Yes, they say that insurance means only term insurance. Otherwise, you're better off investing in mutual
funds. No, insurance means you are transferring risk. If you are doing that in whichever way you can, there is no problem.
Yes.
So, would you like to say anything specific at this stage?
No.
So, okay. Last question.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, everyone. We were discussing this over lunch also. Like, even if we have some other instruments which at times people don't get good returns, why are these products even available? If everyone knows term insurance is good, why are other products available then? Like, it's like...
No, I'm telling you. I'm telling you why they are available. Because we are living in an environment of choice.
Yes.
We are living in an...
Oh, so it is like making them ill and then providing them the pill?
No. If you have money... If you have money, you can buy a term insurance at the point when you should buy a term insurance, and there are many other insurance which actually acts as an investment product after the term insurance. We are not saying, we are just saying if you have equity linked insurance but you don't have term insurance, it is bad. If you have term insurance, insurance is also a major product for pension. It's a major product for investment, but for those people who already have a strong term insurance. And I can also assure you that, let me give you a bad example of a good question. The bad example is, any one of us suffers a pain in the chest 12 o'clock in the night. You are rushed to the hospital because they say the golden hour is 2 hours. From the time the pain starts, if within 2 hours you are in an ICU, there is no problem. So you try your level best to get into the ICU in 2 hours' time. If you are lucky, you start with an ICU ambulance itself. And then the family members, close family members, also rush to the hospital. After that, the doctor comes out wearing those mask and cap. And then he says, well, he's stable, but he has 3 blockages. And you have 3 options. You can do ballooning, you can do angioplasty, and you can do bypass. Now, your near and dear one is in the hospital, fighting for his life. And you are saying, that's a jo aapko samajh mein aata kareen hai, the choice is yours. And I will only do what you say. I cannot do it on my own. So then you have never heard of these terms before. Then you say, that sir, kya hai? So he says, ki ballooning mein ek do saal koi problem nahi hai. Angioplasty, 2-3 years. And bypass, he's as good as new. So is he actually giving you a choice? For a family member, will you do anything for 1 or 2 years? You will not. But he wants you to say it, because you are living in a world of choice. You don't go to Raymond to buy your clothes anymore. You go to a mall. You see 20 things. And by the time, and then you decide whether you have to buy or not. And malls used to have 2 problem places. One was the trial room, the other was payment. And now within a period of time when malls were settling down in India, we have converted the whole mall into a trial room. So we go to a mall, pick up 20 type of things, wear them, do a photo, take a camera photo, then come and order it on Amazon and Flipkart. The whole mall is now a trial room. So this is the time, you are living in a world of choice. So the specialist who is supposed to take the action, he is now passing on the responsibility to you, and also want you to sign off ki agar kuch galti se ho jaye, then you told me to do so. So usse man, I am sure selling insurance is a lesser crime. No, but having said that, term insurance is the right time to buy term insurance. But insurance per se is not a bad product. It's a bad product that you only buy things in which you feel you will get some return. I have number of insurances, but I also have a term insurance. Yes, you are wanting to clarify?
Yeah, we are mixing up insurance and investment. And that's what insurance companies are doing.
No, we are not mixing up.
Yeah, maybe. See, it is said by experts that you should not mix up insurance with investment.
See, they are playing with your mind.
Sorry?
They are playing their mind. Like Chetna ji, 2-3 times bola, uske baad bhi aap manne ke liye taiyar nahi. You can always say, don't mess up with me. But you don't say it. You say, ha, please mess up with me. I want to buy an equity link. I want to buy a saving product. I want to buy a tax product, you can still say, भाई आज के पहले आप नहीं बोल सकते थे. Today you have Professor Google to tell you what is what. You don't require any third persons. You are ready to do selfie, WhatsApp throughout the day on things. But you have Professor Google. You go and put money in fixed deposit, but you don't see how are the 10 top mutual funds doing. So it's an easy way. They mess up with you. But and you are not the rural woman who says, I don't want this product. Yes. You can say that. Good. That's the right answer for this. Okay? So let's break at this stage and give the panelists a big hand. And let me also, on behalf of NCP, give them a small token of our appreciation.